Well, thank all of you for being here today. I know we had even more folks who were hoping to be here, but with all that's going on, weren't able to make it. But having conversations with some of you throughout the week and beforehand, I know many of you have known Brother Mike a lot longer than I have. I only had the privilege of being he and Miss Suzanne's pastor for a couple years. And I use that word privilege intentionally. It was an absolute privilege to have him as a part of our church family. He was a blessing to me as his pastor, a blessing to everybody who knew him in our church body. Always willing to serve, always eager to help, gracious, generous, and just from a personal perspective, just a pleasant guy to be around. He was witty and outgoing, and I was just telling Brother Ed in the back, always positive, always encouraging to be around. And I think maybe the thing that struck you the most about him was just how big-hearted he was. I think everybody who I've talked to has stories about how generous Brother Mike was, how open-handed he was. He must have 12 or 15 times insisted that I come by the house sometime and take the Camaro out to take my wife out on a date. Now, classic car people are usually pretty particular about their cars. In fact, I was talking to a guy in our church this week, and he was saying that he had gone by, there were some classic cars out in Waycross, and he went by with his sons to look at them, and he had a talk with his boys before he got there, that it was important as they looked at those cars that they look but not touch, that folks who have those cars are pretty particular, and if you touch, it might cause a scene. And so he said they walked around and looked. He didn't realize Brother Mike was there until they got to Brother Mike's car, and then he just insisted they get in the car and touch everything they wanted to touch, and that's just the way he was. I mean, even insisting that we let him take the camper at some point and park it somewhere so our family could go stay in the camper for a weekend. Just big-hearted and kind and generous, a good man, a good man. You know, there's the passage in the Bible where the religious leader comes up to Jesus and says, well, what's the greatest commandment? You remember that passage? And Jesus says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. The sum of the law is love God and love people. And Brother Mike did both of those things very well. He loved the Lord and he loved people. In fact, one of the conversations we had just before they joined our church family, he pulled me aside one Sunday morning because there was something he needed to know before he joined. And what he wanted to know was how our church was involved in missions. He wanted to make sure if they were going to join a church that there was some sort of significant mission effort where money and resources and people were involved getting the gospel to the nations. And he wanted to know how he could be involved in it. You know, if you love Jesus and you love people, at some point you want to make sure those two things connect. You want to make sure that people are going to come to know Jesus. And Brother Mike did that. Just another quick conversation. I was talking to a guy in our church this week, and he said, when he looked at Brother Mike, he saw a man that's what he wanted to be when he got that age. That he looked at Brother Mike, and because he was a man's man, he was a good friend, he was involved in the lives of his family, he loved his grandkids. So we're thankful for him. I'm thankful for you, Ms. Suzanne, and just the time that the Lord has put you guys in our church. Genuinely a good man. Now, I want to be careful there because I don't want to give the impression that the reason we have hope at this service is because Brother Mike was such a good man. That's not what gives us hope today, and y'all know that. He was a good man, but our hope is not in Brother Mike's goodness. He was a good man, but like all of us, he was a flawed man. He loved the Lord, but he didn't love God perfectly. And that's what God requires out of us. He requires we love him perfectly. He's holy, and he demands that we also be holy. There's even the verse in the Bible that says, God's eyes are too pure to even look on evil. He can't allow it. He can't tolerate it. And of course, the problem that poses for us is we're chock full of it. We come into this life with hearts bent towards sin. And from the moment we're old enough to make our own decisions, more often than not, we decide to ignore the God who made us and do our own thing. And what we deserve for that is God's judgment. The Bible doesn't sugarcoat that we deserve to be separated from God forever in hell. So just to make sure I'm clear on this, if your hope is that you'll live a good enough life and by your goodness you'll earn heaven, you'll be sorely disappointed. We can't earn anything from God with our goodness. And so the key question days like this draw to mind is, so where do we find hope? Man, we're at a funeral service. Where is there hope in a service like this? And our hope is that while we can't earn anything from God, Jesus has earned it for us. That's what we celebrate at Christmas, right? Not just that a baby was born, But this baby's God in flesh, and he came, Matthew 1 says, to save his people from their sins. He came to bear our sin debt to the cross. He came to take God's judgment. He came to rise from the dead to conquer death, so that now those who turn from sin and trust in Jesus, who put their trust in him, are fully forgiven. And the amazing thing the Bible would say is that when our trust is in Jesus, death is transformed. I mean, you have these radical statements in the Bible, like Paul in Philippians 1, where he says, to live is Christ and to die is gain. That sounds crazy. But for Christians, death is actually gain. To depart or to be absent from the body, Paul says, is to be present with the Lord. So we know, while this is a heavy day, a sorrowful day for us, we know what this means for Brother Mike. And not to mention, one day the Bible even promises that these bodies are going to be raised up. One of my favorite passages, listen to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting in verse 51. Paul writes, "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible puts on incorruption, and the mortal on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that's written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." I like that phrase, that death now for the believer is swallowed up in victory. Because Jesus took our sin, because Jesus rose from the dead, those who trust in Jesus, the sting of death's been taken away. That means when Brother Mike's heart stopped beating in that hospital room in Brunswick and he was pronounced dead, he was actually more alive than he had ever been. He immediately entered into the presence of the Lord that he loved, and we have the promise that one day death will even lose its grip on his body. So we hold on to that hope. So just I'll close with this. We go through services like today with heavy hearts, but as Christians, we don't go through services like today with hopeless hearts. We know that because Jesus died in our place and rose from the dead, those who trust in him, and I have confidence Brother Mike trusted in the Lord. I heard his profession of faith. I saw evidence of that faith. For those whose trust is in Christ, death does not have the last word. So let me pray for us. Father, we are thankful, as Paul says in 1 Thessalonians, we are thankful that while we grieve, we don't grieve as those who have no hope. We thank you, Lord, that because of Christ's death and resurrection in our place, death does not win. It feels today. It can feel at funeral services like death has won, but we know because of Christ, death does not have the victory. Death will not have the last word. And so, Father, I pray in the middle of this time and in the middle of the sorrow that there would be that thread, that light of hope that would uphold Brother Mike's family, that they'd be encouraged by the good memories of a good dad, a good husband, a good grandfather, Lord, and that they'd be encouraged more than anything by the promises that you've made us in Christ. We pray, Lord, that above everything else and in this service, Christ would be honored, and we ask for your help in that. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
that last trumpet sound.
My feet won't stay on the ground, on the ground. I'm gonna rise with a shout of fire. I'm gonna rise with my Lord through the sky. Heaven is near and I can stay here. Goodbye world, goodbye world, goodbye. Goodbye.
You know, the image that came to my mind when that song started playing? Stacia, you remember at your wedding when y'all came out and they started playing and y'all started dancing?
Yeah.
Person sitting next to me said, I didn't know Mike had that much rhythm. We're going to do things a little bit differently. I know that all of you love Mike and have fond memories. And most of you, if you were emotionally able, would be happy and glad for the opportunity to say something. But I also know that most of you right now are having a very difficult time emotionally with that. But I am going to give you an opportunity, if you'd like to tell us a funny story or something about Mike that maybe we know or we don't know, or something that would be meaningful to the family. I want to give you that opportunity, and to open that up, I can count on my cousin, David Merck. David, come on. I know David's always ready to say something. Never seen this man. He was like Mike. He never met a stranger, and I've never seen him for a loss of words.
How many words do I get?
Just keep it short.
Let me get out my paper. You know, you try to think of something that'll encourage you, and you know, that song done a whole lot for me just then. You know, most time you go to a funeral, you hear these real sad songs, but I like upbeat songs. So one thing I remember Mike said a lot, and I think it's very true today, you'd ask him how he's doing, he'd say, top shelf looking down. Well, buddy, he's at the top shelf looking down today, you know, and that's great. You know, you can judge your friends, too, by what you hear other people say. And, you know, if you judge it like 1 to 10, I'm not quite a 10. He never offered to let me use his car. Never time. And I asked him one time, let me borrow it. And he kind of shook. But they did offer for me to go stay with him at Moccasin Creek several times. Me and Natalie come on up there and stay for a week with him. Of course, we never did, because some of us aren't retired all the time. You know, we couldn't do some of those things. You know, you said a mouthful when you kept emphasizing Mike was a good man. You know, I've known Mike for, I guess it was around 12 years when we met. We started going to church together. We kind of met at the same church about the same time with Brother Ed. And I got to know Mike and Suzanne, you know, fairly well. One thing you could say, there's a lot you can say about Mike. He was as godly a person as I've ever known. He loved people. He loved his family. He talked about his family all the time. He loved people. He'd do anything for you. You could ask him for something, and if he could do it, it was done. If you needed something, he was more than willing to help you get it done. You know, there's very few people in the world that you'll meet that was like Mike Wiggins. I mean, very few people. And it was just an honor for me to know him and for him to be the part of my life that he was. And I know that I heard Brother Ed say this one time at his mama's funeral. He said, how did you say this? Our pain is her gain. And basically, we're sitting here today and we're grieving, you know, and in the few days ahead, that's when the grief is really going to set in, probably for everybody, most of y'all. But y'all got all those great memories to remember. Y'all got all the, you know, the love and the compassion and the caring that Mike had for y'all, and that's what's going to get y'all through. I got some funny stories I could probably tell, but, you know, I'm kind of scared to tell some of them. Because it might, you know, you might not think so highly of him when I tell you. I really don't have anything that, I don't have anything I don't think that I could say in front of y'all that would embarrass Suzanne or that Mike wouldn't want me to say.
Well, we're not jerks, so you can let loose.
Oh, yeah. Well, I remember one time that, you know, we would always joke around a lot. we go to the house and shoot pool, and, you know, we wouldn't be at the house yet, and I'd be talking to Mike. I said, well, look here, you got the beer. You want me to bring the beer? He said, no, I got plenty. Just come on over. You can drink mine, you know. And I know he's kidding, and you know he's kidding, and he knew I was kidding. We would joke around like that a lot, you know. And you could joke around with Mike all you wanted to, but you had to keep it on a level that you weren't talking against anybody or talking against God in any kind of way. Mike was as, I don't like the word that you use the word religious, a person, but Mike was as, he was as dedicated a Christian as you'll ever meet. And I believe that from the bottom of my heart. He was. I mean, he really was. And I know Brother Ed and him was, you know, they were like brothers. And I know Brother Ed's going to miss him tremendously, like a lot of us are. You know, we just got to realize that, you know, Mike's not with us anymore, but his legacy and his memories, they'll carry on forever, especially with y'all. Y'all will never forget Mike. Nobody will ever forget Mike that ever knew Mike, and that's who he was. He was just a great guy, and it, you know, it was an honor for me to know him the short time that I did. And we just keep y'all lifted up because I know y'all are going to need it. And you know, now that he is gone, are you taking that orange Camaro I've seen you driving the last few days? You need to slow down a little bit, buddy. You know, I saw him going across town the other day, and he don't know that I saw him, but he was parked over there kind of by the old water tower, and he was talking to some of his buddies. And as I was pulling around the corner, and I got around the corner where he had just been, I saw two black streaks on the road. And I think it come off of that Camaro. So
they were stuck on the road. I was trying to get them off.
Y'all don't believe that either, do you? No. So, you know, anytime y'all want to let me borrow that Camaro, you know, I'll drive it. I'll take care of it for you. Anyway, I love Mike. I love Mike. And I love his family, too. My prayers go out to y'all.
Thank you, David.
You're welcome.
All right. Thank you, David. Anybody else? Come on.
This is a poem that Jesse wrote, and she asked me to read it. I'm gonna try to get through it. He is no longer warm, but cool to the touch. He is no longer in motion, like he has been for so long. He worked harder than anyone I've ever known. He worked happier than anyone I had ever known, even on a bad day. But bad days did not exist to him. I've never seen someone so happy to be exhausted from a long day's work. I've never seen someone so happy. Showing unconditional love is easier said than done. And he did both with every breath he took. There was never any doubt in any of our minds of just how much he loved us. He was my greatest hero and my truest friend. There was not one thing he couldn't make better. He filled the empty spaces left behind in my heart happily. He saved me from myself by showing me just how much I meant to him. Loving myself seemed plausible if he could love me so easily. Everything I am is because of the love he showed me. Everything I will be because of him. Oh, what I would give to hold you for just one more minute.
All right. Anyone else? I want to thank Jarrod for your remarks today, Jarrod. And Mike and I often talked about his membership at the church, and one of the things that we both appreciated so very much was your ability to expound the scriptures and the hours you must put in study. But you got to remember, Mike was a big jokester. And I asked him one day after we were talking, I visited the church, I said, Mike, why'd you join that church? He said, "Have you seen the preacher's wife? She's beautiful." And he did love you and Miss Courtney. He really did. I share with you scripture. Matter of fact, this first scripture is one I shared at my mother's funeral. And all of the verses I'm going to read to you at first sound a little hard to wrap your head around, because in Psalm 116, verse 15, the Bible says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of one of his saints." And that word precious means very special. And I often wondered how anything that is so painful for us down here could be precious in the eyes of the Lord. But you see, he knows their gain, and we are focused on our pain. And therefore, sometimes wrapping your head around the scriptures is not the easiest thing. The wisest man, Solomon, said in 7:1, "A good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of one's birth. It is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting, for that is the end of all men, and the living will lay it to his heart. Sorrow is better than laughter, for by the sadness of the countenance the heart is made better." Wrapping your head around that scripture is made a little easier when you think of what Paul said in Philippians chapter 1. He said, "For I am in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better." Not just a little bit better. Far better. No comparison better. Unlike anything we have ever seen. And I chose those scriptures because I want this family to know, and especially Suzanne, y'all have fleshed these out. I have watched y'all exhibit the grace of God in a way that has made Mike extremely proud. And more than that, has exalted your Savior and your Lord Jesus Christ. I thank you for that from the depths of my heart. Not a lot of things I know, but I did not realize this until really a couple of hours ago. It's been a long time now, but when my brother-in-law was 45 years of age, he wasn't feeling real well on a Monday morning, but went to the office. He was a pastor. Went to the hospital, made some visits, came home, told his wife he wasn't feeling well. On Monday evening, he said, "You better take me to the hospital." She did. And on Wednesday night, he was gone. I was somewhere in Orlando, Florida on that particular day when my sister called me and answered the phone, and she said, "Eddie, I want you to do Terry's funeral." I assured her I would, and I hung up, and it literally felt like my heart was going to burst out of my body. I burst in tears and finally got control and reached over and picked up a cassette by a singing evangelist of mine, and I placed it in the player, and he started singing, "The anchor holds, though the ship be battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm." Y'all have exhibited that wonderfully well. Little did I know, a little over 15 years ago on a Sunday morning, God was sending two of the greatest blessings of my life to my life, Mike and Suzanne Wiggins. Mike and I became best friends. I've never had a friend like Mike. Just day before yesterday, it seemed like the Lord said to me, Ed, think about this. If I'd come down from heaven and told you that I was going to do something for you I've never done for another living person, and that is this, I want you to make yourself a friend, a perfect friend, a friend among friends. And as I thought more and more about that, it would not have mattered how hard I had tried, I could not have made a better friend than Mike Wiggins. Mike and I shared a lot, same beliefs, same tastes, same thoughts, and we were always figuring things out. Man, we've solved a lot of the world's problems. The problem is the world didn't listen to us. But one of the things that we figured out that most people never figure out, most people are always wondering, well, you know, what's my real purpose in life? Well, Mike and I figured that out. We both came to the conclusion about the same time that our calling in life was to prove at least three times a day you couldn't fix stupid. And most days we got our quota before noon. And I was thinking just today about one of the stupidest things that Mike and I ever did. I bought a motorhome, and the generator had a problem. That was a 8,500 kilowatt generator. I think weighs around 500 pounds. I'd taken it out and taken it to a man in Jacksonville. Mike and I went and got it, loaded it on the back of our pickup truck. He put it on there with a little forklift. When we got home, we had a problem. How are we going to get that generator off of that thing? Now, Mike and my weight combined was far less than 400 pounds. But we decided we was going to lift that generator off that back of that truck. You can't fix stupid. I'm telling you. We got that thing to the edge of the bed of that pickup truck. Man, it came off of there like it was shot out of a cannon. We didn't even slow it down. Mike did get a bad scar out of that deal. And I tell you that to tell you this. Thursday, I went back for another COVID test. Was going to anyway. I got in my car, punched a button, ding. The information center, it said, no key detected. I thought, boy, that's pretty stupid. You didn't get your key. I opened my car door to get out, and Suzanne, it was just like, as I looked up, there was Mike, had that little grin on his face and said, buddy, we can't fix it. And with that, a grin and he was gone. Well, I just want Mike to know I'll carry on our legacy. I'll try to get our three in before noon every day. Now, with that thought in mind, I think Mike's biggest legacy, and it's already been mentioned here, was his love for his wife and his family. My, not known two more complete fulfilling people than Mike and Suzanne. Can't tell you how many times I've heard him hang up, say, bye, girlfriend, I love you. Can't tell you how many times, Jamie, I've heard y'all close out a conversation. I love you, son. Can't tell you, Stacia, how many times I've been in the car. Hey, baby girl, how are you? He loved his family, loved his grandkids. Oh, my soul, he loved them. And I think that's probably the thing that he was most exemplary in. His spiritual gifts were three, especially. One was exhortation. As you said, David, how you doing, Mike? Top shelf looking down. If it got any better, it'd have to be a twin. And he just spread that everywhere he went. I mean, we'd go into a restaurant. It didn't matter whoever he met. I mean, he was always so positive. And people loved him for that. But then the gift of giving was his also. I could tell you time after time where Mike has given, I mean financially, and of himself, just over and over again. But I think the thing that brought him the most pleasure was his gift of service. Somebody said this, and when you think about it, it's true. Have you ever wondered what people mean when they say, well, bless your heart? My daughter told me one time, she said, Daddy, you know what people mean when they say that? And I said, no. She said, what they mean is, I'm sorry, but I'm not going to do a thing about it. And when you think about that, it's generally, well, we can't do anything about it. But you know, Mike always, I mean, it didn't matter who he was talking to. He always ended with that. If you need me, call me. And those weren't just words to Mike. He absolutely meant it. And time, it didn't matter where we were, what we were doing. If that phone rang, Mike answered it. And if somebody needed something, whether it was advice or on how to do something or whatever it was or needed him, you could be sure Mike was going to be there. That was just Mike Wiggins. Man, what a guy. I guess there's so much I could say, but I will conclude with these words. Mike, you're my buddy, my pal, my friend. It will be that way until the end. And wherever you go, I want you to know you're my buddy, my pal, my friend. And though our time down here has come to an end, it won't be long, and I'll see you again, my friend. Heavenly Father, I'm sure today that my expression of gratitude is echoed by everyone in this room. Our lives have been made extremely richer because of Mike and Suzanne Wiggins and their family. Bless them bountifully. In Jesus' name I pray, with thanksgiving. Amen.